Amen. Would you stand to your feet as we read God's word? And it comes from 1 Peter 5, 5 to 11. And it says, God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So humble yourselves under the mighty power of God, that at just the right time, he will lift you up in honor. Give all your worries and cares to God. How many are going through some stuff today, right? Sharon asked you, people are going through difficult things today. Give all your worries and cares to God, for he cares for you. Stay alert. Watch out. For your great enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for somebody to devour. Stand firm against him and be strong in your faith. Remember that your family of believers all over the world is going through the same kind of suffering that you are. In his kindness, God has called you to share in his eternal glory by the means of Christ Jesus. So after you have suffered a little while, he will restore, he will support, and he will strengthen you. What a good word that is for you today. He will place you with a firm foundation, a foundation that can't be shaken. All power to him forever. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day. We thank you for your presence that's with us today, Lord. And thank you that you've chosen us for such a time as this. Lord, I pray for the sponsored children today. I pray that every child would be sponsored. Father, I thank you that you've chosen us to be a blessing overseas. And Father, I pray that we would bless those, Lord, overseas. And Father, I thank you, Lord, that these children would have everything that they need. Pray that you bless Pastor Andrew, Lord, and the persecution that he's facing. Father, I pray that you protect him, cover him with the blood of Jesus for his comings and his goings and everywhere you're leading him, in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for those that are facing persecution. We pray for the nation of Israel. We pray for your chosen land and your chosen people. They're not good because they're good. They're good because you call them good, because they're your chosen people. So, Father, I pray today, Lord, you protect your chosen people today, Lord. Father, I pray that you reveal all the wicked schemes that are happening in the nation of Israel, in Jesus' name. Father, we pray for the other side, the Palestinians that desperately need you. Bring them to a lasting knowledge of faith in you today, in Jesus' name. Father, we think of Chris and Tony this week. Lord, tomorrow is their sentencing. And Father, I pray today, Lord, that you would give them mercy, in Jesus' name. Father, whatever the judge is planning, Lord, if it's not of you, I pray that you would give him a restless sleep tonight. I pray that you would change his mind, Lord, to the mind of Christ tonight, in the name of Jesus. I pray that you would arrest him spiritually in his bed tonight, in Jesus' name. Father, I pray that you would set the boys free tomorrow, in Jesus' name. Father, I pray for a peace that surpasses all understanding over Chris and Tony. I pray that you give them a peaceful sleep tonight, a peaceful sleep to their loved ones tonight, Father. Lord, we thank you for all that you're going to do in their situation. Father, I think of those that are sick in the congregation and have been battling sickness. We pray for healing for Daryl's knee and pray for recovery for Belinda as she had surgery. Pray for recovery for Willie, who's here today, Lord. Thank you for healing him, Lord, from the top of his head to the bottom of his feet, Lord. Father, for all those that aren't well, we pray for Bob and Joan. Bob's coming back to church very soon, Bob and Joan. Father, we pray that you continue to heal them. Lord, anybody else that I may be missing, Neva, Lord, pray for Neva today. We thank you for Neva, Lord. Heal her shoulder in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you, Lord, but by the stripes that you took on the cross, we're healed in Jesus' name. We pray for others that have had diagnoses that aren't from you. Father, we speak against those curse words in the name of Jesus, and we speak healing. We speak the cells and the alignment of the blood vessels and everything, the organs, to come into the perfect alignment of Jesus Christ. Thank you for the miracles that you're doing during this time. Thank you that we serve a God of miracles. Thank you that we serve the great physician. And so, Lord, we thank you for all that you're going to do. Thank you for all the miracles that you're doing during this time. Father, I pray for the word today. Lord, I can't speak a word that will impact everybody, but your Holy Spirit can. And so, Father, today I pray that you would use my words, Lord, that you would anoint my words. Lord, may they flow from the power of your Holy Spirit today. I pray today, Lord, that we would leave this place different than what we came. And we thank you for all that you're going to do, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. You may be seated. There is joy in the house of the Lord today. Amen. And we won't be quiet. We'll shout out his praise. And I won't start singing. Praise the Lord for all of you. Well, you can turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 1, 1 to 3. Revelation 1, 1 to 3. And it says, this is a revelation from Jesus Christ, which God gave him to show his servants the events that must soon take place. How many know we're going to see some events take place really soon? He sent an angel to present this revelation to his servant John, who faithfully reported everything that he saw. John didn't work for CNN. He wasn't a part of fake news. This is his report of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. God blesses the one who reads the words of this prophecy. Thank the Lord. I'm blessed for reading this to you today. But he also blesses you who listen to this message and obey what it says. Not just listen to the message, church, but obey the message. For what it says, for the time is near. This is a revelation from Jesus Christ. It doesn't get much more important than this, church. God gave this vision to John through Jesus Christ to show him the events that must soon take place. Last week's message, we spoke a message on the persecuted church, the church of Smyrna. It was one of the churches that Jesus had no condemnation for. I believe the main reason for that is persecution makes us worthy of the kingdom of heaven. The Bible says suffering makes us worthy of the kingdom of God. And I believe that's why the church of Smyrna was not persecuted that way. They didn't receive the condemnation from Jesus because they were faithful in the midst of difficult times. And I pray that for our church. The more we get persecuted, the more faithful we are. Amen? The more things happen to us, the more we're persecuted in the community, the more faithful we become. May we have the attitude of Christ Jesus that it's an honor to be persecuted. It's an honor to be hated for Jesus. They hated him first before we were hated. Amen? Today's message is the compromised church, the church of Pergamum. You hear many believers say that we're in the Laodicean church age, which is the lukewarm church, but I believe we're also in the compromised church age. How many know the church has been compromised? The Western church has been compromised. The church of Pergamum was compromised, and I'm going to give you just a bit of background on Pergamum. It was located along the Caicus River. The city of Pergamum was built on a hillside 1,000 feet up, giving it natural protection. What a beautiful picture, right? How many would love to live on a hillside 1,000 feet up, right? It was the center of Greek culture and education. The volume of the library that was contained in Pergamum was 200,000 volumes. That's a lot of volumes. Pergamum is now modern-day Bergama, which is in Turkey. You can do a Google search and see that there are remains of the pagan temples to Roman gods and emperors. Only faint traces of the church can be found there. Turn in your Bibles to Revelation chapter 2, verse 12. Revelation chapter 2, verse 12. This is the message of Jesus Christ to the church of Pergamum. It says in verse 12, write this letter to the angel of the church in Pergamum. This is a message from the one with the sharp two-edged sword. This message comes from Jesus, just like all the other messages to the seven churches. It's in the red letters of Jesus. And it's interesting how John pens this as the one with the sharp two-edged sword. A sword brings judgment. And we know the love of Jesus, but we also know the justice of Jesus. Amen? Jesus will not let sin go unpunished. He will judge the world, and he will judge the corrupt churches. Revelation chapter 2, verse 13, Jesus goes on and says, I know that you live in a city where Satan has his throne. yet you remain loyal to me. Sometimes I feel like Satan has his throne in Red Deer. Don't you feel that way? Or maybe if you live in Lacombe, you might say Satan has his throne in Lacombe or Black Falls or Penhold, or use any community that's around here, Sylvan Lake. Jesus says, I know that you live in a city where Satan has his throne. Jesus is aware of what is going on. Yet you have remained loyal to me. You refuse to deny me, even when Antipas, my faithful witness, was martyred among you in Satan's city. Jesus begins with an affirmation to the church of Pergamum. You are in the city where Satan has his throne, but you have been loyal to me. That's my prayer for the remnant and street church, that we would remain loyal to the Lord. They were loyal to Jesus. They didn't deny him, even when facing persecution. But over time, the pagan practices crept their way into the church. Pergamum was the city where Satan's throne was. And I want to dig into this right now because I think it's very important that we have an understanding of this. And I'm going to show this through scripture, which will help you understand that I believe that's where Satan's throne was. If we look back at history, Pergamum was the site of the altar of Zeus, or the throne of Zeus. Zeus was king of the gods, and in Greek mythology bears the same name as Rome of Jupiter. He is associated with the Canaanite god of Baal-Zephon, Lord of the North. In the New Testament, Baal-Zephon became Beelzebub, or Lord of the Flies. Maybe we have that Beelzebub spirit in central Alberta with the Lord of the Wasps right now. I don't know what's going on with those stupid things. All throughout history, we've seen many nations worship false gods. They just give them different names, don't they, church? There is nothing new under the sun. It never changes. History doesn't change, but and yet the education system is trying to wipe history out. If we don't know history, history is due to repeat itself. It says in Isaiah 14:12. This is the prophet Isaiah speaking, and he says, how are you fallen from heaven, O shining star, son of the morning? The prophet is speaking about Satan in this scripture. How are you fallen from heaven, O shining star of the morning? You have been thrown down to earth. You who destroyed the nations of the world. And then he quotes Satan himself. He says, for you said to yourself, I will ascend to heaven and set my throne above God's stars. I will preside on the mountain of the gods far away in the north. Everybody following me today? This scripture is very significant for a number of reasons. As you know, Pergamum was built on the mountain and on the side of the hill in modern-day Turkey, which is far north of the holy city of Jerusalem. We read in Revelation 2:13 that Satan's throne is in Pergamum, and these scriptures are obviously both speaking about Pergamum. You see, in Pergamum, there was temple shrines, altars, and even the coins at Pergamum all demonstrated strong inclination to the worship of pagan gods. Nothing has changed. Look at our money system. It's all got somebody's face on it. It's all about idol worship, really, right? Worshipping the forefathers, even the forefathers that did good things. It's all about idol worship. We look back at the church of Pergamum, we go, how can they worship all those idols? Well, we're still doing it today. They worshiped even the serpent. The serpent was the most prolific image on the coins of Pergamum. Isn't that interesting? How many know when you follow an ambulance into town, what do you see on the back of the ambulance? A snake. A serpent on the back of an ambulance. Of the very people that we're told are trying to help us. We know that pharmacy has its Greek name in pharmakia, and we know it's demonic. It's meant to steal, kill, and destroy. I'm thankful for good doctors. We do have good doctors. We have Wu Jie in our church, good doctor. There's lots of good doctors that I know, but this system is meant to steal, kill, and destroy. They're literally worshiping a serpent in healthcare. They're worshiping a servant in pharmacy. How many know that? It hasn't changed very much at all. It strikes me so odd as I'm driving into town, an ambulance whips by me, and I see a snake on the back of the ambulance. I go, this is crazy. This is crazy, but we're living in a society that the devil wants to steal people's lives. It's a society of death. Just look at what's going on with MAID. It's a society of death. Look what's going on with abortion. Society of death. Look what's going on with all the policies of the government. It's a society of death. It's meant to cripple you and destroy you. It hasn't changed. The plan still hasn't changed. It breaks my heart as I drive in, and I got to give myself more time on Sunday mornings. It breaks my heart. I'm driving in, and I'm coming through South Red Deer, and there's a pharmacy. It's called IDA. It's right by Petrocan. And as I'm driving in, every Sunday as I drive by, the doors are shut. You can see they have the big steel doors shut, but there's people sitting on the sidewalk. Sitting on the sidewalk, waiting an hour, 2 hours before the pharmacy opens, just for a shot so they could talk to a doctor that could make them well, a doctor that could heal them. And I go, there's something wrong with this. There's something wrong with this. What has the church done to allow people to go and wait for a doctor to help them when we serve the great physician, the only one that can heal them? And so I'm going to give myself some more time, and maybe some of you want to come with me on Sunday morning. And maybe we're just going to go out to the pharmacy and just heal some people so they don't even need to go into the doctor's office. They're worshiping a serpent and a snake, and they don't even know it. How will they know? We studied this in Romans this week. How will they know unless somebody tells them? How will they know unless somebody preaches the gospel? How will they know unless somebody shows them a different way? We are living in a world that is lost. We know that Satan is referred to as the serpent in the book of Genesis, the serpent that deceived Adam and Eve. You see, I believe that Zeus could be just another name for Satan under a different name. How many know that Satan can masquerade as different things? And Satan could masquerade as Zeus very easily. Many gods were worshipped in Pergamum, such as Zeus, Athena, Roma, Isis. What an interesting name. Right? Serapis, Dionysus. These gods are actually, I believe, demons. They are some of the principalities that is warned about in the Bible, that Paul warns us about in Ephesians 6:12. We war not against flesh and blood, but against the evil rulers and the authorities and the principalities of this dark world, and against the evil spirits in the heavenly realms. It's the authorities that are in Red Deer Church. There is a spiritual authority that has been allowed to function in this city for years. A spiritual darkness that's been allowed to function. The church has gone, okay, have your way, just do it. Well, let me tell you something. That's why we're facing so much persecution, because we're stirring up the hornet's nest. I love stirring up the hornet's nest. I love walking out there and preaching the name of Jesus, because every time I preach the name of Jesus on that lot, I'm kicking that hornet's nest. And those demons are starting to go zzz. These demons that are in the RCMP, zzz, demons that are in AHS, zzz, but more importantly, spiritual demons that are in this community that have been allowed to function in the city of Red Deer uncontested. But finally, We have a church that's willing to stand against the demonic in downtown Red Deer. Finally, we have a church that's unafraid to preach the gospel. Finally, we have a church that is saying, no more Satan. Downtown Red Deer doesn't belong to you. Downtown Red Deer belongs to Jesus Christ. Amen? So you see in the scripture in Isaiah that Satan says, I will preside on the mountain of the north. It's telling us that Satan rules over this mountain of the gods or demons, which is far north of Jerusalem. We know in Romans 2:13, Satan's throne is in Pergamum, as we just read, which is far north of Jerusalem. Let's continue on to see what Jesus says to the church of Pergamum in Revelation 2:13. Revelation 2:13, he says, you refused to deny me. Even when Antipas, my faithful witness, was martyred along with you in Satan's city. Antipas was the leader of the church in Pergamum. See, that's what they attack. If they can attack the leader, then they attack the church, right? So they want to take the leader out, because you take the leader out, you take the church out. That's why it's so important, church. I'm just going to say it. It's so important that you pray for us every single day. It's so important that you pray for the protection of us every single day. We're fighting battles that you don't know anything about. I'm just being honest. And we need the blood of Jesus over us. We need the armor of God over us. It encourages me so much to know that we do have a praying church that is standing with us and praying for us. So thank you so much for praying for us, church. Antipas was the leader that they took out. Many believe that he was slowly roasted to death inside a bronze statue of a bull. How many know that does not sound like a good way to die? But it's interesting how they burned him inside a statue of a bull. When you look at the bull, is actually a very demonic, they use it all over America. It's a very demonic image. New York City, right on Wall Street, there's a bull. Huge bull. You look at it in Calgary, there's a bull in downtown Calgary too. They put it in all these areas. It's all about idol worship. Many believe Antipas was roasted to death inside a bronze statue of a bull, which is a symbol, church, and a companion of Zeus. How demonic is that? The altar of Zeus was 40 feet high. How many know that's a big altar? Very large. It had steps going up to it, even pillars. So there was lots of room for a bronze statue of a bull. Antipas was killed because he didn't compromise. Did you hear me? He was killed because he didn't compromise. That has been the attack on the church the last 4 years, is to compromise. We're just going to shut you down for 2 weeks. Just abide by what we tell you to do. We're just going to tell you that you can't lay hands on people. We're just going to tell you that you can't feed the poor. We're just going to tell you to just compromise. We're not telling you all these other things. We're just going to tell you not to do these things. Satan's plans have never changed. So you may be asking, where is the altar of Zeus today? In 1901, German archaeologists removed the massive altar from Pergamum and took it to Berlin. You know where I'm going next with this. It was restored as a centerpiece in the Pergamum Museum, which opened in 1930. This all happened shortly before Adolf Hitler came to power and tried to establish a one world order. In fact, Hitler built a large outdoor replica of the altar. Are you following me, church? Which is where he gave many of his grand speeches to the Nazis. It's very clear who Hitler was getting his marching orders from. Satan himself. It's very clear through our world leaders where they're getting their marching orders from. Satan himself. Fauci gets his marching orders from Satan himself. Biden gets his marching orders from Satan himself. He may forget it 30 seconds later. Harris gets her marching orders from Satan himself. Justin Trudeau gets his marching orders from Satan himself. They are bought and paid for by the enemy himself. World leaders selling their soul to the devil. It's a serious situation, but that's where we see ourselves today. So Jesus continues on and speaks some correction to the church of Pergamum. Some of you are going, oh, pastor, wasn't that a correction right there? No, the correction's coming. Revelation 2, 14 to 16, he says in verse 14, but I have a few complaints against you. How many know you don't want Jesus to say that? I have a few complaints against you. You tolerate among those whose teaching is that of Balaam, who showed Balak how to trip up the people of Israel. Balak was a king who feared the large number of the Israelites traveling through his country. I believe it's similar to today. We have a prime minister that fears the Christian church. It's why he persecutes us so much. It says Balak hired Balaam to pronounce a curse on the Israelites. Balaam refused at first, but an offer of money changed his mind. The story is found, I won't read it today, the story is found in Numbers chapter 22 to 24. Balaam influenced the Israelites to turn to idol worship. Numbers 31, 16. The last part of verse 14 says in Revelation chapter 2, he taught them to sin by eating food offered to idols and by committing sexual sin. In a similar way, you have Nicolaitans among you who follow the same teaching. You see, over time, paganism and Christianity were being packaged together, much like today. You see, Balaam taught compromise. He wanted the Christians to forget that they were called to be holy. Isn't that amazing? The same teachings are today. That's why the church doesn't preach about holiness. That's why the church doesn't preach about sin. Don't talk about that. You don't want them to live the only life that'll give them freedom against the enemy and his ways. Balaam also taught, really it was a way to get Christians to be so lukewarm that you couldn't tell the difference between people that said they were believers and people that were of the world. Does that not sound similar to today? I can't tell you how many times I meet Christians during the week. Christians, I'll use that term lightly. People that say they're believers of Jesus Christ, they live like the devil. They live like the world. There is no difference. It has all been planned. I actually believe, as I was studying this week, this is the spirit of Balaam that has come across not only our nation, but all the nations of the world. A spirit to deceive people into putting them to this apathy and complacency. This spirit really taught them to indulge in all the things of the world. It's not that bad. You want a little sex outside of marriage? Go have a little sex outside marriage. You want to be wealthy? Just fraud this little situation over here. God understands. Just hide that money right there. God understands. You don't like your wife? Get a divorce. You don't like your husband? Get a divorce. Slowly started to creep into the church. Are you following me today? Basically, where it's come down to, the world sacrifices everything. The elites, the entertainers, the sports athletes sacrifice everything for popularity, money, and sex. Unfortunately, people that call themselves believers in Jesus Christ do the exact same thing. They sell their soul to the devil for popularity, sex, and money. It's no different today. Paganism has crept into the church just like it had in Ephesus. But the truth of the gospel always sets us free, church. It always sets us free. What's unfortunate is Christ died on the cross to abolish this wickedness. Christ died that this abolishment should be cut off. And yet the believers in churches just reestablished all that Christ abolished. Man, that's tough to hear, but it's the truth. Christ cut it off, and the church goes, no, we're bringing it all back in. Jesus instructed the disciples to go into the world, Matthew 28. Go into the world, preach the gospel, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded. But in Pergamum, the world came into the church, just like in Canada, just like in Alberta. Listen, culture can't change the church. Church changes the culture. Culture can't change the church. The church changes the culture. It's up to us to set that standard differently. But unfortunately, you walk in most churches and they look the same as the world. Celebrating with Christmas trees on a Sunday morning. Lights all over their churches. Easter, they have the Easter bunny running around in a costume in the church, handing out Easter eggs to children in church. Even worse yet, you have churches that celebrate Halloween by having demonic witches hang from the roof of their buildings. And if you think I'm crazy, I've seen it with my own eyes. The youth pastor dressed as a witch. I've seen it with my own eyes. And the world walks in and they're playing Rihanna. Go grind up against each other. Have sex wherever you want. And then the church goes, how come our kids are straying? How can we send our kids to college and they're falling away? How can we send our kids to university and they're falling away? Why are my kids serving Jesus? Why? Because you're teaching them to serve Satan. You're okay with your pastor and your church letting them serve Satan. That's exactly what's happening. The common denominator in all of these things is to distract our children from Jesus. Santa, the Easter bunny, and through Halloween, Satan himself is meant to distract our children. Every year I've preached a message on Halloween, this year will be no different. I'm going to preach that message until Christians start getting away that filth and that junk. This year we're going to do a roast, location still to be determined. Last year we did a roast, a demonic roast. Anybody that had demonic stuff, videos, DVDs, music, literature. We just stood at a fire and people just kept dumping it in. I remember we put it in a big burn barrel and we put gasoline in it, lit it up. When we lit that thing up, boy, this demonic face just came right on out of it. And for those of you that are there, I have the picture of it. I can prove it to you. Demonic face came out of all that junk. Come on, church. We got to stand against this compromise. We'll take a quick look at the ancient goddess of Ishtar, who is also known as Samaris, the ancient Babylon queen. According to historians, Samaris believed that her son was conceived by the sun god. Her son's name is Tammuz, which is really interesting because Tammuz is actually mentioned in the Bible. It's Ezekiel chapter 9, I believe, chapter 8. Tammuz is briefly mentioned in the Bible. She made herself and her son the objects of worship. Does that sound like a faith that's in this country today? Just follow me with this for a minute. She set herself up as the only approach to God. She taught that salvation came through sprinkling of water and cleansing. The Roman Catholic Church was birthed out of paganism. She adopted the title of Queen of Heaven. While hunting one day, Tammuz was killed by a wild animal. She mourned for 40 days, the account says. And at the end of the 40 days, Tammuz was raised to life from the dead. She formed a celibate priesthood and named a chief priest she declared to be infallible. Who do you think that is? The Pope. You can't make this up. That's not all. She created temple virgins to pray for her son, nuns. They also fasted for 40 days, and they would celebrate the Feast of Ishtar, which we now call Easter. They gave colored eggs to each other to celebrate eternal life. Don't you dare tell me that Easter is not a harmful holiday. If you are participating in that, you are participating in paganism worship, church. I'm just being honest. The 40-day mourning is also now called Lent. The Yule log, the evergreen tree, and the mistletoe, and even hot cross buns were all used in rituals that they instituted. Like, it has gotten in so deep. And it got in so quick that the church didn't even see it coming. And now you have churches in this community that have Christmas trees on their stage. They have Easter eggs on their stage. And they have witches hanging from their roof. Crazy. This has all been part of Roman Catholicism, where it remains to this day. But Jesus has an important message for the church of Pergamum. He says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 16, repent of your sin, or I will come to you suddenly and fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Do you think that Jesus takes paganism and compromise seriously? The church today must repent of their sin and allowing paganism, idolatry, and compromise into the church. Jesus hates moral compromise. He calls us to live differently, a life of purity, to be set apart from the world. We have a responsibility to remove false teachers from the church that would seek compromise. That's why we've done it as long as this church has been around. Listen, there's hills to die on in our faith, and there's hills not to die on. But I will die on the hill every time that Jesus Christ is our Lord and Savior. And I will die on the hill that repentance is key to living in freedom. I will die on the hill that Jesus is the only way to heaven. There are no 75 other ways to heaven. I'm sorry for anybody that thinks that way. There's not. There's one way to heaven, and it's through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Jesus wants us to live pure lives for him. The good news is, church, as I wrap this up today, the good news is Jesus makes a final promise to all the believers, to the ones that are victorious, the overcomers. He says in Revelation chapter 2, verse 17, anyone with ears to hear must listen to the Spirit and understand what he is saying to the churches. To everyone who is victorious, I will give some of the manna that has been hidden away in heaven. I will give each one a white stone, and on that stone will be engraved a new name that no one understands except the one who receives it. I don't know about you, church. I don't know if you've read that before. As I studied that, that just jumped out of the pages at me this week. Jesus ends this rebuke with promises. Jesus ends this rebuke with those that are repenting of their sin, those that are overcomers, victorious. I will give you three blessings, Jesus says in this scripture. Manna, a white stone, and a new name. We know that manna sustained the Israelites when they were in the promised land. Manna sustained them, physical manna. But Jesus isn't talking about physical manna. He's talking about spiritual manna. Spiritual manna in the scripture. I will give you spiritual manna. I will. The more you seek me, the more that you find me. Those that seek Jesus will never be disgraced. The world may try to shame you. The world may try to distract you. The world may say, faith doesn't work today. Faith doesn't work. Why are you doing this? Why are you living like this? Faith was for 2,000 years ago, not for today. No, no, no. The best thing that you can do in your lives, young people, children, serve Jesus at a young age. Develop your own relationship with Jesus, not because your mom and dad say it, but because you have a good relationship with Jesus. Obey your parents. Obey your mom and dad. When they tell you to read the Bible and they tell you to pray, dig into the Bible. Dig into God's word. Ask the Holy Spirit to reveal himself to you, and he will reveal himself to you so that you know that God is real. He promises to give us spiritual manna. How many know the world is seeking something that it cannot find? The world is seeking something because we're created spiritual. We're created to want for something more than the world has to offer. Jesus said, I came for that. I am the bread of life. All those that come to me won't be hungry for all this stuff in the world anymore. All these people that come to me will be filled. I will give them living water. I will give them living water. I will give them new life, those that put their faith in me. The white stone. There's many scholars that question what the white stone could mean. I believe the white stone could symbolize us as believers are washed clean, white as snow, by the blood of Jesus. Those of us that have confessed Jesus as Lord and Savior, it's just as we've never sinned, justification that God has given us through faith in Jesus Christ. He has given us that stone. And last but not least, it says that he gives us a new name. You're no longer lost. You're found. You're no longer an orphan. You are adopted, son and daughter. You no longer are sinner, you are called righteous. You are no longer alone. You have a Savior that loves you so much, that gave up his life for you, that has given you a new name. We don't understand that, church. We look at it when Jesus died for the whole world. He died for the world, but he died for me and you. But he's going to give each one of us a new name. That's what the scripture says, a new name that no one understands except the one who receives it. I want you to just rest in that thought today. Jesus is giving us a new name that no one else knows. It's literally like Jesus going up to us and saying, I got a special secret for you between you and me. This is my name that I'm giving you. This is your new name. What a beautiful Savior. A Savior that is so relational with us, that each one of us has a different relationship with Jesus. Things don't change. Salvation doesn't change. But all of us can say we have a different relationship with Jesus. I think we could safely say that. Jesus means something different to each one of us. But the promise remains the same. Those that come to Jesus will receive a new name. Amen? I want to give an opportunity for anybody that's here today that may not have a new name. Maybe you wonder what this is all about. Who is this Jesus? Who is this Jesus that takes away the sins of the world? The Bible says that God sent his one and only Son. He lived the life we should have lived. He died the death we should have died in our place. 3 days later, he rose from the dead, proving that he's the Son of God. To all those that repent and all those that call on his name, he promises to give us the gift of salvation, eternal life and abundance on this earth forevermore. He promises to never leave us nor forsake us. So if there's anybody here that has never accepted Jesus Christ, I want to give you an opportunity right now. If you've never accepted Jesus today, would you raise your hand just right now with me? Anybody here that's never accepted Jesus, just be bold and raise your hand today. Is there anybody in this place that doesn't know Jesus today? Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. There's no hands up, so I believe that everybody here knows Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, I just pray, Lord, for your church today. Lord, may we be known as a church that is loyal to you without compromise. Father, I pray that you would lead us through the power of your Holy Spirit and through your word, that we'd be so close to you in this season that we wouldn't be distracted on the things of this world. Help us, Lord Jesus, to serve you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. We love you, Jesus. We worship you. In Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. We're going to end the service with communion. I really feel like, Daryl, you can come up. I really feel like it's important that as we go into this new season, as we come out of summer church, I know by talking to some of you, summer's been distracting. Summer's been great, but summer's been distracting. And now it's time to refocus. We're in the fall. It's time to refocus all your thoughts on Jesus. Amen? It's time for you to come to Jesus and just have a moment with him and say, Jesus, I want to give my life to you anew. I want a strong relationship with you. No matter what's coming, I want to have you as the solid foundation in my life. And so today, I just want you to prepare your hearts before we get into communion. You can bow your head. I'm just going to read a scripture out of 1 Corinthians 11, chapter 11, verse 27. It says, so if anyone eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord unworthily, that person is guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord. That is why you should examine yourself before eating the bread and drinking the cup. For if you eat the bread or drink the cup in an unworthy manner, not honoring the body of Christ, you are eating and drinking judgment upon yourself. That is why many of you are sick and some have even died. So today, church, just in this quiet moment, nobody's looking at you, nobody's looking around. In this quiet moment, the same God, the same Jesus that gave you a unique name that nobody else knows your heart. He knows the things that are hidden that nobody else sees. Today, if you want to make yourself right before the Lord, if you just want to repent maybe of apathy over the last couple months, you've just gotten distracted with the things of life, maybe that's for some who just want to repent of those things, or maybe you have unconfessed sin in your life that you need to repent of right now. It could be a relationship. Could be a bad relationship with somebody else that you just need to take to the Lord. Or just anything that is separating you from God. Just take a moment. Just pray to Jesus. Just be real with him. He knows it all anyway. Just be real with him. Take time in this holy moment unto the Lord. And we'll ask the ushers to hand out the elements. And as they're passing them out, just continue in that spirit of worship. There's a beautiful presence of the Holy Spirit that's here right now. There's just something that's different when you encounter the living God, the Spirit of the living God. I believe when we encounter who Jesus is, thank you, Jesus changes everything. Jesus changes everything. You understand the majesty of God, the greatness of God, the goodness of God. Can't help but just worship a worthy God. He alone is worthy of all of our praise. As we remember today, as we take part in the bread that represents Christ's broken body and the blood, which is represented by the juice, may we just recognize the greatest sacrifice at all. Jesus gave his life for me and for you so that you would have eternal life. He went down to hell and grabbed the keys of hell, death, and the grave. He died on that cross. Even if it was just for you, one person in this place today, he would have died for just one person. He loves you that much. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Exalt you in this place, Lord. You are worthy of all of our praise. There is no one like our God. There is no name higher than the name of Jesus Christ. God gave him the name that is above every other name. Every other name. There is no one like the name of Jesus. Song, I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt thee. Amen. 1 Corinthians 11, 23. Paul writes, "For this is what the Lord himself said, and I pass it on to you just as I have received it. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it, said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" So I just invite you to partake with us. Just pull the plastic off the top. We'll reveal the wafer. Let's all partake together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for all the stripes that you took. Thank you that you took the crown of thorns. You were beaten for us so that we could be made whole. We thank you for your sacrifice today. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Good, good God. Thank you for loving us so much. Nothing compares with you. No one like our God. Amen. Amen. Verse 25 says, in the same way, he took the cup of wine after saying, this cup is the new covenant between God and you, sealed by the shedding of my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again. Let's partake of the juice, which represents the blood of Christ today. Let's partake of it together. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Thank you, Lord, that your word says, by every stripe that you took on the cross, that we're healed. Thank you, Lord, that you came to heal all of our sicknesses and all of our diseases. Thank you, there's nothing more powerful. There's no agent that's more powerful than the blood of Jesus. Thank you, we're saved by the blood of Jesus. Thank you that we're healed by the blood of Jesus. Thank you that we're protected by the blood of Jesus. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that cleansed us from all of our sin. Thank you for the blood of Jesus that when that drop of blood landed on the ground, it tore the veil. The separation that we had with God was broken forever. We are brought into right relationship because of Jesus's death on the cross. But we thank you today, Jesus, that we don't serve a God that's dead. We serve a God that is very much alive. You're not on that cross anymore. You are coming back for a pure and spotless church. We thank you, Jesus, that we look forward to your coming. We look forward to Jesus coming back very soon again. We thank you, Jesus. We worship you. We give you all the praise. We give you all the glory. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Church, just a beautiful sense of worship in the house today. The beautiful sense of the Holy Spirit. You just sense him moving over all your lives as we're praying, as we're taking communion. Powerful remembering who our God is. Amen? Amen. Would you stand to your feet as we sing one last song of worship to our Savior?
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, at the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you, I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin, like a flood.
Amen. I'm just going to pray over you. Jesus, I pray, Lord, over every single person that's here, that's a believer in you. Your word says that you will give us the hidden manna. Thank you for the hidden manna. Thank you for the bread of life and the living water that sustains us no matter what comes against us. Thank you for the living water and the bread of life today. Thank you for cleansing us. Thank you for the white stone that washes us white as snow today, Lord. Thank you that shame is broken off. Anybody that's in this place with shame, it's broken off in the name of Jesus Christ. No shame on anybody. It's been taken to the cross in Jesus' name. Thank you for the new name that you've given us. A new special name that each one of us has that you will reveal to us when we see you face to face. Thank you that we have a special relationship with you today. Lord, may we trust you in ways that we've never trusted you before as we move forward in this season. Father, may we be closer to you than we've ever been. May we be loyal to you no matter what we face. We thank you for all that you're doing, Jesus. We give you all the praise and glory in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. 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 May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. And the name is above every other name, the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Be blessed, church. You are not dismissed. Dismissed means you can just live the same. You are sent to go make a difference in the world that we're living in. Be blessed. Walk in the authority that Jesus has given you and have yourselves a great week. Love you all. Look forward to seeing you again soon.